My story started in 1983. I was 18 and I was a very active person, and I particularly enjoyed playing softball as the pitcher. In June 1983, I started a novice job. When the softball season finished, I started to get treatment for an ankle injury. I received physiotherapy with some kind of pulse therapy. A little while later, I started having trouble with my arm, and my hand turned bluish. I didn't feel too well, and it was very uncomfortable. All I wanted to do was sleep. However, I continued working, with my line managing insisting I saw a doctor. The following morning, I met my GP, who sent me straight away to A&E after seeing my hand and arm. A few tests later, it was apparent that there was a blood clot blocking the vein in my upper arm. I was admitted and put on a heparin IV. Professor Breslau and another vascular surgeon were discussing whether I needed an operation or just on the anticoagulants. I stayed in hospital for 5 days, and luckily they put me on the anticoagulants and didn't need an operation. My lifestyle changed dramatically. I was 18 and no longer I was allowed to take part in any contact sport, which included my beloved softball. It had a great impact on me. The worst memory I have about the time was the lining up at the thrombosis clinic. I was in a queue with all old people. I felt embarrassed and very out of place. After 6 months on the anticoagulants and quite a few checkups, I was allowed to stop the blood thinners. They still checked me regularly, and I was not allowed to go on a combined pill. Apart from this, I was allowed to lead a normal life. Later, when I became pregnant, I had to be under the supervision of the gynecologist and a vascular surgeon. The two consultants were based in the same hospital, and they had good contact with each other. I was put on Ascol from 3 months gestation until the birth. After the birth, I had to have heparin for 5 days. I was lucky I didn't have too many complications. I had the same treatment while I was pregnant with my two other children. I realized I was very lucky that everything went well, although at times I felt different from my friends who were allowed to be with a midwife. That seemed so relaxed and also medical. But that said, I was lucky to have three fairly complicated pregnancies. In 1996, 5 months after the birth of my third daughter, I moved to England. It meant I had to leave my family gynecologist and vascular surgeon, and I enrolled with my local GP. I gave them my full medical history, but they did not seem to be worried about my history of blood clot. A few years later, I even had an operation in a private hospital, and I wasn't given any anticoagulants. For years, I had to. For years, I had a busy job at a drama school and was always running around. In 2011, I decided that I needed a change and applied for an office job. I started at the end of June 2011, and to make up for the change of lifestyle, I had attended the gym very regularly. Once again, I'm trying to piece together the events to make sense of what has happened, but I cannot know if they really contributed. One day I tripped over the dock in the utility room and I had a deep wound on the top of my foot. I didn't think much of it, and the district nurses who I worked for were not concerned either. A week or so later, my arm started hurting badly. I was suspicious, so I went to the GP. I told her that I recognized the pain and the uncomfortable feeling, and that I suspected a DVT. The GP disagreed and told me it was nerve pain. A few days later, I visited the GP practice for the second time. As by now, I really felt unwell. This GP, it was not the same one, suggested a D-dimer test. The D-dimer test came back negative, and therefore the GP excluded the DVT. Even my line manager, the district nurse, said, "Thank God it's not a DVT." And all I said, and I remember this as yesterday, but what is it then? Unfortunately, the pain increased, and I actually started to have additional problems. I started sweating enormously by just moving my arm, which was very embarrassing. I was not able to walk without getting out of breath. I visited the GP practice again on a Friday and just asked this GP, the third GP, something for the pain, as it was not bearable anymore. This Westchester GP I call her name, Trina Lescue, took the time and acknowledged that I had a previous DVT in that arm. She phoned a supervisor and asked for advice. I was sent to the thrombosis clinic to exclude the DVT. As they did not seem overly worried, I returned to my office to finish off my work with the intention of going to the hospital later. Within an hour, the hospital phoned me and asked where I was. They had looked into my notes and were worried. At arrival, they put me straight on a hospital bed and had an ECG sats meter, and my sats kept dropping dramatically as soon as I started walking. A further Doppler found a big clot under my arm. I had a subsequent X-ray, but I didn't want to stay in the hospital, and I was allowed to go home on the condition that I came back every day for 5 days to get my Clexane injections. I'm more than able to do that myself, but I wasn't allowed. I was put on warfarin, and that was it. No further tests took place. The pain in my arm remained, but I thought it was just from the clot. In January, I had my follow-up appointment at hematology, and I was told I didn't have TOS, but just to stay on the well warfarin for the rest of my life. That diagnosis was made after examining the X-ray that was made in November. Unfortunately, the pain in my arm did not disappear, and I asked my GP for a referral to the vascular surgeon. I changed GP, but I was still at the same GP practice. I asked them to discuss my case in order to avoid repetition in future with other patients. I had to wait months before I saw Mr. Mitchell, and actually it was his registrar, Mr. Beavers, who found out that I had TOS, as I didn't have a pulse in my pulse when I lifted up my arm. We tried physiotherapy, but this made it worse, and the physiotherapist was a bit too worried to continue. December 2012, 13 months after my DVT, I was referred to Mr. Thompson, who with some simple diagnostic tests found out that I had TOS, nerve, vein, and artery. In April 2013, I had the first rib resection, followed by a venoplasty in May. Of course, it takes time to recover from this operation, but my blood flow was still not optimal, and further venoplasty took place in 2014, as the vein was still or again compressed. In 2014, I thought I wanted to start on the new anticoagulant rivaroxaban. After a week, I felt unwell. My arm was in pain, and I was admitted to hospital. They could not find anything, and I asked them to take me off the rivaroxaban and back on the warfarin. They reluctantly gave in. A few months later, when I had recovered, I tried the new medicine again, as it has so many favorable properties. This time I started to have abdominal pains. First they thought it was appendicitis, then a UTI, PID, PR bleed, and so on. Once again, I had to beg them to get me off the new medicine. They were very reluctant, but finally allowed me to go back on warfarin. Although I really liked the idea not to have all the INR checks and the side effects of the warfarin, I do not want to start a new anticoagulant at this moment. The pain combined with the fact that people don't see that you're in pain can make me feel extremely isolated. It's difficult to explain pain, even to your GP. And although I really appreciated that my GP is very honest, she tells me that she had never had anyone with my problems. It also aggravates the feeling of being on my own. I still take a lot of painkillers and medication for arm pain. I'm lucky that my practice works with a named GP, so I always try to see her. One little illustration why it's important. A few weeks ago, I was in agony with my arm. I have no idea why it keeps happening. My hand was cold and I could not get the pain under control, even with the normal pain. The hospital nurse had advised me to use Oramorph on those occasions. However, mine was out of date, so I needed a repeat prescription. The GP practice told me I had to see an emergency doctor for this prescription, as my own GP wasn't in. This GP did not know anything about my arm history, and I came in there after waiting 35 minutes, as he asked me if physiotherapy was a good idea. I'm having physiotherapy at the moment. It's in my notes. Followed by if I wanted to try anti-inflammatory. What is inflamed? She also asked if it was a rivaroxaban. My notes say warfarin, so I didn't have much confidence in her. She also asked if I wanted to up the amitriptyline dose. but I'm not depressed. The amitriptyline is for the nerve pain. She emphasized that Ouroboros was addictive. I rarely use it, and I really needed it, and to have been advised of the side effects. I felt so dreadfully lonely and misunderstood. All I wanted, all I needed was to sleep and get the pain under control, as the pain makes you extremely tired. Experience has taught me that on those flare-ups, I don't need to go to hospital. They don't last more than a few days. All I need is just to sleep. All this said, I realized that the emergency doctor can't read all your notes. Unfortunately, it's one of those things. In the last year, I've started... In the last year, I've started treatment with the pain clinic. The first station was the tense therapy. That didn't work, unfortunately. After that, it was the acupuncture. I had one flare-up during the acupuncture, and they couldn't tell me if it was related to the acupuncture. I'm now having physiotherapy. I'm still in pain, and cold weather makes it worse. I've had another phenoplasty that showed some compression when I lift up my arm. The vascular surgeon was very honest and told me that it was not his specialty, and he referred me to Mr. Black in London. I know that I'm lucky that I could continue to work, and because of my experience, I've got a big thing for health and safety. I became a health and safety rep and tried to educate employees the importance of good working posture at your desk. Prevention is better than cure. If I could turn the clock backwards, I could start again from 2011, I would do things very differently. I would no longer do long hours at the desk and would regularly stand up and walk around. I would favor a headset over wedging the phone between my ear and my shoulder, as well as numerous other little things that might have prevented me from getting a second DVT. I'm not the type to sit at home and feel sorry for myself, so I've carried on in going to the gym as being as active as I can. One of the things I really wanted to achieve was to run the Bristol 10K for the thrombosis charity. To put more pressure on myself, I wanted to do this before I turned 50, so I didn't have much time to prepare. I succeeded on the 31st of May, and I raised £339 for the thrombosis charity. I would like to give my special thanks to Trina Lescue for a decision to send me to hospital in 2011, and to my GP, Claire Wilson, for continued support. Thank you for listening to my patient story.